So this is a lecture on post-colonialism. Section 1, we'll talk about colonialism itself. Colonialism refers to the extension of a nation's sovereignty beyond its borders. A nation like Spain or Portugal is extending its sovereignty beyond its borders. How? By the establishment of settler colonies, in which indigenous populations are directly ruled or displaced. Imperialism is the ideology of colonialism. It's a set of beliefs used to legitimize or promote this system. So there are two terms, colonialism and imperialism. Then there's a third term, cultural hegemony. Cultural hegemony is the domination of one culture by another, based on the ethnocentric belief that the morals and values of the colonizer were superior to those of the colonized. The colonizer or the white man held himself superior to the colonized peoples in the West. This placed the white people at the top of the animal kingdom. Naturally, the white man is superior, in charge of dominating non-European aboriginal populations. Next, let us talk about imperialism and colonialism in more detail. Imperialism is almost as old as the state, or as long as human beings are there, imperialism has been there. Colonialism, however, can be traced back to 3,000 years ago to the ancient Phoenicians. European colonialism had two broad waves. European colonialism started only with the 15th century, with the discovery of America. 1492 to roughly 1582 is the first phase. The second phase is from 1850, or the middle of the 19th century, to the end of the Second World War. The second period is more imperialistic. The first wave was the time of explorations, geographic discoveries. It was even called the Age of Discovery. This was also the period of religious zeal. There were missionaries trying to convert indigenous people across the colonies into Christianity. It was at this time in the first wave that colonies were established, East India companies were established, and the Spanish colonial masters called the conquistadors destroyed the Amerindian populations also during this period, the first wave. The second wave period, the 19th century to the end of middle of the 19th century to the middle of the 20th century, is called the period of new imperialism, because it was in this period that the colonial expansion of the European powers happened. The European powers, not only European powers, the US and Japan were also colonial powers at this time. They held sway over Africa and Asia. The colonization of Africa was a very important thing in history at this time. This second period was also the period of rivalry between the great colonial powers. And during and after the Second World War, there happened the disintegration of the colonial powers. Next, let us take a quick look at the purposes of colonialism. The first and major purpose was procuring land and settlement. This was what happened in the Americas, the North and South Americas. There was also the religious purpose in two ways. The Pilgrim Fathers who went to America escaped from persecution, religious persecution. So that was one religious need behind colonialism. The second was to convert people into Christianity. Thirdly, there was the exploitative colonialism, which had an economic purpose, that is to make money, trade and commerce, to amass natural and human resources. And around $45 trillion were made from India in their 173 years of ruling India. Then there is the moral purpose of colonialism, which is called the white man's burden. The white people had a moral sense of responsibility because they genuinely thought that they are morally, culturally, and ethically, as well as intellectually, superior to the Easterners and Africans. So they wanted to educate us, enlighten us, civilize us. It was Rudyard Kipling who wrote the poem, White Man's Burden. Then there was social Darwinism, or survival of the fittest idea, a feature of society is to fight for available resources. Especially in the 19th century, it became accepted that it is okay to fight for resources, to dominate over other people. Because of Darwinism at this time, they believed in survival of the fittest. So these are the purposes of colonialism. Next, we'll take a brief look at Western colonial history. Western colonialism began in about 1500, that is the beginning of the 16th century. Just before this, Christopher Columbus had landed in the Bahamas, that was in 1492. And Vasco da Gama had discovered the sea route to India, that was in 1498. With this, sea power shifted from the Mediterranean to the Atlantic region. And the major colonial powers came into being: the UK, France, Spain, Portugal, and Netherlands. Colonialism was aided by trade and commerce, technological inventions which made geographic discoveries possible, and cartography or map making. British colonialism began in the 16th century, and they established overseas colonies at about this time itself. And the British Empire came into being in the late 18th century, with colonies established in America and the West Indies or the Caribbean islands. The first phase of British colonialism concentrated in the New World, West Africa and India. And it closed or ended, that first period ended with the American Revolution for Independence. Independence came in the end of the 18th century to America. By 1914, British Empire covered one-fifth of the world's total land surface, and it ruled one-fourth of its population. Obviously, the greatest need was economic. Political, linguistic, cultural legacy spread as a result of colonialism. The British political systems became popular. English language became popular, British culture became popular, and there was established the empire where the sun never sets, because somewhere in the empire, the sun has risen. Look at the map of the British Empire in 1914. The yellow regions are the British Empire, a lot of North America, major parts of Africa, entire India, Australia, and other parts of Asia. Then we'll talk about post-colonial studies. Post-colonial studies as a discipline began in the late 1970s and early 1980s. It was based on post-colonial fiction that was published immediately after the Second World War. At this time, the post-colonial was also referred to as the Commonwealth of Nations, all ruled by the British Queen. The term Commonwealth is no longer in use now. And then there was also something called Third World Studies that emerged as a synonym for post-colonial studies. It was the French demographer Alfred Sauvy who coined the term Third World in 1952. During the Cold War period, the US and the USSR came to be the First and Second Worlds. And the post-colonial countries came to be the Third World. Frederick Jameson has written a controversial essay called Third World Literature in the Era of Multinational Capitalism. Now, there's another word or term, Fourth World. It refers to the subaltern and aboriginal communities within the Third World. That means the Dalits, the natives, who are all living within the post-colonial nation. They are one doubly marginalized. As the Third World, they are marginalized. Within that, they are further marginalized. So, Fourth World. So, that is an introduction to post-colonial studies. We'll take a quick look at the aims of post-colonialism. Post-colonialism aims to analyze the process of decolonization. It studies cultures that were formerly and currently colonized. And post-colonialism challenges the universalist assumptions of liberal humanism. So, post-colonialism studies decolonization in the countries that were formerly colonized or even currently colonized, and it is against universalist ideas. It embraces difference. It reclaims the past because the past was lost in the colonial process. And it engages in new disciplines such as South Asian studies, subaltern studies, resistance studies, historiographic revisionism, etc. South Asian studies, because these countries were erstwhile colonies. Subaltern studies is about Fourth World. It is about the subaltern people within the post-colonial nations. Resistance studies, resistance against colonialism and other forms of power. History is text. They rewrite history. They reclaim history. That is historiographic revisionism. Now, after the introduction to post-colonialism, let us come back to colonialism and identity. In the post-colonial nations, we have to realize that our identities have been heavily defined by colonialism. Whole countries, along with social groups and divisions within them, were colonial inventions. Many modern political boundaries in West Africa, for instance, are based on linguistic, political, and economic contrasts that are the result of European colonial policies. What do you mean by that? European colonial policies brought some linguistic, political, and economic conditions that resulted in West African countries. In other words, Europe cut up Africa in unnatural ways. European colonialism cut up Africa in unnatural ways. And this has a destabilizing effect on the ethnic groups in Africa. The result is that there is perpetual civil war in many countries in Africa because the colonial masters cut up Africa in a very wrong way, in an unnatural way. Traditionally, they needed to travel from, for example, take India, you'll understand better. Kabuliwalas came from Afghanistan to India easily through Pakistan. And there was no restriction of national boundaries before partition. But the British game of divide and rule led to the partition of India. And Pakistan and India were formed, leading to perpetual fighting between these two nations. The natural trade and commerce that happened between Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India stopped. And many things that we need, like natural resources, for example, that India and Pakistan both used, got divided. It is very unnatural. The British rule has been largely responsible for this fight between India and Pakistan. Look at the map of Africa, you'll understand. Look at the boundary of Mauritania and Mali, for example. It's like it is cut with a pair of scissors. Look at all the small countries that are formed. None of them would be self-sufficient. They would struggle for survival and they would fight with their neighbors. Look at this region of Africa. It is so sad because of British colonial, the vestiges of colonialism, all these small West African nations are still struggling. Now let us take some look at examples of colonial attitude. Look at this 19th century advertisement for Pears soap. Haha, it uses the term white man's burden. The first step towards lightening the white man's burden is through teaching the virtues of cleanliness. Cleanliness is what is belonging to the white people. The black people do not have cleanliness. Look at a black man getting the lesson of cleanliness from the white man. Cleanliness is a colonial construct. And it uses, this advertisement uses the white man's burden, encouraging white people to teach cleanliness to members of other races. I think after seeing this advertisement, I never used Pear soap again. Look at this picture of the white settlers in Australia. They landed in Australia, and even though the wilderness of Australia was inhabited by Aborigines, these white people did not even consider them human beings, I suppose. They called this land Terra Nullius, or land belonging to no one. because these aborigines who lived there are closer to animals for the white people. Terra nullius. This is a cartoon made by Victor Gillam, White Man's Burden. Is it White Man's Burden or Black Man's Burden? Here you see the African carrying Uncle Sam, the representative of America, and an Indian carrying John Bull, the representative of United Kingdom. Now, this is a satirical definition of aborigines given by Ambrose Bierce in the Devil's Dictionary. Aborigines, he says, this is from a white perspective, attacking the white perspective. The aborigines are persons of little worth found cumbering the soil of a newly discovered country. Very sadly, he says, they soon cease to cumber. Cumber means litter. They fertilize. That means the white people kill them and they begin to fertilize the soil. Very sad. So many aborigines were killed by the white people, the conquistadors of Spain. Colonial literature was there. Literature written during the age of colonization or about the age of colonization from the point of view of the colonizers. Literature of the British Empire is an example. For example, Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe, Rudyard Kipling's Tales from the Hills, Plain Tales from the Hills, Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, as well as Lord Jim, and E.M. Forster's A Passage to India. Let us take a closer look at these books. So what is colonial about Robinson Crusoe? This novel tells the story of an Englishman who reasserts his Christian, moral, and British superiority and also develops a sense of identity from all this. On the surface, it is an adventure story, but it is actually a representation of a white man setting up a colony in an uninhabited Caribbean island. Black Man Friday is the representative of all the primitive, savage, cannibalistic natives who are subjugated by British imperialism. And Crusoe transforms Friday. He reforms him by teaching him Christianity and the English language. And Rudyard Kipling was infamously a writer supporting imperialism. It was George Orwell who called him the prophet of British imperialism. Plain Tales from the Hills is Rudyard Kipling's first collection of short stories set in Shimla. These 40 short stories are about the British India of the period 1886-87. And Shimla, incidentally, was the summer capital of the British Raj. And then there is Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, a searing picture of exploitative colonialism and geographic exploration that is integrally connected with imperial domination. The narrator Marlowe continually points to the evils of imperialism, but also suggests the horrors of what the darkness of Africa can do to the civilized white man. And A Passage to India by E.M. Forster records the transitional moment of India's transformation from a British colony to an independent country. Though Forster suggests that the British rule is necessary and good in India because the British bring justice and peace here, he also suggests that true Indo-British friendship is possible only when India would get freedom from the British. So that's all about colonialism for now. Take a break.